Ricardo is not asking any questions. Ricardo, we are celebrating you, but you should keep sharp. Look, let's see if I can provoke you sufficiently. Well, anyway, it's a great honor for me to represent here the younger generation, together with Paolo, the younger generation of the school founded by Ricardo. And it's also a great pleasure to be back in Pisa, where many of us have spent some of the most intense years of our lives, included myself. So we may be elsewhere today, but deep in our heart, we are always here in Pisa. So what is this Pisa School of Theoretical Physics? You know, when I came first to Pisa in 2005, Ricardo asked me to give a talk on whatever I was working on at the time. And it was actually on the black hole information paradox, so something that Gia has just reviewed for us. And so you see Ricardo was pretty open-minded, and he listened politely to what I had to say. And after the talk, I got an answer from a person in the first row. What are the observable consequences? And you know, at the time, I was not very familiar with Alessandro, so I thought, what a jerk. Now, after spending four years in Pisa, I understand that it was actually a very valid question. So I'd like to thank Ricardo for instilling in all of us this pretty simple, but if you look around at what's happening today in theoretical physics, maybe not such an obvious idea, that you should try to work on questions with direct observational consequences. So my today's talk is going to be on conformal field theories, and the simplest conformal field theory, which is experimentally relevant and unsolved, is the three-dimensional Ising model at the critical temperature. So this theory, it describes critical phenomena in many experimental systems. So it describes phase transitions in uniaxial magnets, in binary mixtures, in liquid-vapor transitions, in critical point of strong interactions, so strong interactions matter. It may even describe critical point of gravitons around a quantum black hole, but, you know, I haven't added that to my list, but maybe I should after Gia's talk. So let me remind you. Yeah, and actually there is even a 10 sigma experimental anomaly in this subject between discrepancy between theory and experiment. So it's really worth looking at the system, and let me just remind you what it is. So you consider this cubic lattice with spins, plus and minus spins, and you write a partition function for this cubic lattice. And depending on the temperature, this system can be in several regimes. So if you're considering high temperature, bigger than a certain critical temperature, then the two-point correlation function of spins in this theory is decaying exponentially with distance with a certain parameter xi, which is called the correlation length. But if you approach the critical temperature, well, let's say from above, then this correlation length diverges, and precisely at the critical temperature, the two-point function behaves as a power law. So it's a power law with a certain power to delta. And this is the theory that we would like to look at. This is the critical point. And the critical theory, the theory at the critical point, has two properties. It's a scale invariant theory. So as you see, we have this power law, which is a scale invariant function. But less trivially, it's also conformally invariant, as I'm going to talk about later. And this conformal invariance was conjectured by Polyakov in 71 first, but we think it's true. So in the two-dimensional case, you know, this model has been studied to death, and it was solved exactly on the lattice and for any temperature by Onsager and then by many works afterwards. And actually, it was so the reason why Polyakov conjectured critical conformal invariance of this theory in two dimensions, he noticed that the three-point function of two spin fields and one energy field, which was computed previously exactly by other people, if you go to the critical temperature, he noticed that this quantity was conformally invariant, which nobody observed before. And then later in 83, it was identified by Belyayev, Polyakov, and Zamolodchikov that this critical two-dimensional theory is actually the first unitary minimal model CFT. So basically, everything is known about this theory. But if you look at the three-dimensional case, then at the lattice model, this theory is probably not solvable. So there's an empirical argument for that, that many good and famous physicists tried to do this. They have not succeeded. There's actually a mathematical reason also recently discovered why they could not succeed in 3D. But those theorems, they do not exclude that the critical theory, so the conformally invariant theory at the critical temperature, might be solvable. And you know the reason, again, that there are a few people tried to do it. And those who did, they did not use conformal invariance up to its logical end. And so most approaches to the three-dimensional Ising model so far, they've been used on the randomization group idea. So here you use the phenomenon of universality, which say that you can approach the same critical point from different UV descriptions. And in this case, you can take as your UV description just the free scalar theory in 3D, which is perturbed by two relevant perturbations, in this case by the mass term and by the critical coupling. And then depending on the relative value of these couplings, you may flow either to a massive theory, which may be either Z2 invariant massive theory or Z2 broken massive theory. But somewhere in between, for an intermediate value of the coupling, of the ratio of these couplings, you will flow to this 3D Ising CFT. And you can use this fact to compute many things, to compute approximately many things about this CFT, to compute the critical exponent. So this goes back to Wilson and so on. But this doesn't work too well because this theory is strongly coupled. And you know, in the old days, so nowadays we would even be surprised why this should work at all, because we are considering a strongly coupled conformal field theory, which you know, for which no perturbative expansion should work, but somehow it works, at least to some precision. But in any case, the number of Feynman diagrams grows exponentially, so at some point, given the finite length of human life, you know, any collaboration runs out of steam, and so whatever could be done using RG has been done. So here I'm going to talk about another approach, which is called conformal bootstrap. And the idea of conformal bootstrap, it goes back to the 70s. So the idea is that since these CFTs, which describe critical points, are so universal objects, for example, you can get the same critical point either by flowing from the lattice theory or you can flow from scalar theory and you get the same CFT. So why do you have to describe this theory by flowing to it from any other theory via RG? Why can't you study it in isolation directly? So that was the idea. And this idea was already proposed in the 70s by two groups of people. And one of them was a group headed by Raul Gatto, and it included also Sergio Ferrara and Aurelio Grillo. And I'm very happy because I know that I heard from Ricardo many times that Raul Gatto was also his maestro in a sense concerning QCD. And even I learned today from Ricardo Ratazzi that Ricardo Barbieri attended a talk by Raul Gatto where he was talking about this work in the 70s. I don't know if Ricardo remembers about it. In any case, I'm going to review some of the things that Raul may have said back then. And then there was also Alexander Polyakov in Russia who also had the same idea. So what's this idea? So the idea is to use this non-Lagrangian point of view on the QFT. So you don't talk about Lagrangians, but you concentrate on local operators. By the way, this is also necessary. This is absolutely necessary if you want to describe this critical point in isolation, because these conformal field theories, they don't have particles in them. So they only have correlation functions, but they don't have any particles. They don't have any poles in scattering amplitudes that you can use to construct particles. They only have cuts. So you have these local operators, and mathematically speaking, they form an algebra. So why do they form an algebra? Because the same Wilson who proposed randomization group, he proposed also the seed for this approach under the name of operator product expansion. So those operators, these local operators, you can multiply them, and you can express the product of the operators as a sum of other operators. And the important property of this product is that it has to be associative. So if you take three operators, and if you take product of the two by the third or in the other order, you should get the same result. And the reason why you should get the same result is that there are four-point functions, so there are other correlation functions, which are well-defined measurable quantities, so, and you compute them using the OPE, and since these functions are well-defined and single-valued, it means that this OPE has to be associative. So that's the idea. So you see, this is a non-Lagrangian approach to quantum field theory. There is no mention of fields. There are no fundamental fields. All operators enter on the same basis. So it's a little bit similar to the S matrix program in particle physics in the 60s. And you might think that being so general, this program is doomed to the same destiny as the S matrix program has. But actually, you will see that it's in a bit better shape. It can make predictions and it can produce numbers. So why conformal? So I was talking about this conformal invariant theories, and the reason why I'm allowed to do this is that, so my theories are by definition scale invariant because these are fixed points, phase transitions, and so they have their correlation functions. If you apply a dilatation transformation, then they get rescaled by this factor 1 over lambda to the power equal to the sum of operator dimensions. So this would be scale invariance. But in the conformal invariant theory, there is this special transformation, which is called spatial conformal transformation, which is kind of a nonlinear version of this dilatation transformation. Nonlinear in the sense that this scale factor lambda is x dependent, and there is also an extra quadratic piece here. And it turns out that in the conformal invariant theory, correlation functions are invariant also under this kind of nonlinear dilatations. So if you transform axis using this transformation, then again the correlation function transforms in the same way as under normal dilatation, except that these lambdas become x dependent. So this is a non-trivial fact. And the reason why I'm allowed to do this is because there is a theorem that generically scale invariance plus locality implies conformal invariance. So if you have a local theory with a local stress tensor operator, then scale invariance is going to imply conformal invariance. And there is an argument here that I don't have time to review it, but basically you can express in this field language both scale and conformal invariance as an equation involving the trace of the stress tensor, and then it turns out that this equation generically implies this equation. So I'm going to assume conformal invariance. And once you assume conformal invariance, then you can do many things. You can do much more things than if you just have scale invariance. So for example, you have many constraints on the correlation function. So you can work out two-point functions in terms of the operator dimension. You can work out three-point functions also in terms of the operator dimensions. So and here you have these numbers appearing, the operator dimensions, which I denote delta, and also these three-point functions coefficients, which I denote as f. So these numbers These are pure numbers, and they are called conformal data. So to solve a conformal field theory means to find these two sets of numbers. So if you know these numbers, you know everything. In particular, you can also compute all other correlation functions. So for example, four-point functions. So four-point functions, if you just use conformal invariance, they are not fixed up to a number, but they are fixed to some function which, you know, a priori looks like it's an arbitrary function of two conformally invariant cross ratios, U and V, so which are defined like this. But actually, it's not an arbitrary function, but it can be expressed in terms of deltas and Fs. So if you know this, then you can compute everything else. And here, you use this concept of OPE, so which I already mentioned. And the point being that, so the concept of OPE is general, it's applicable in any quantum field theory, but in a conformal field theory, it's particularly powerful because these functions that appear in the right-hand side, which multiply these operators, in a normal quantum field theory, you don't know anything about these functions. They are non-perturbative, very difficult to compute, and impossible to compute. But in a conformal field theory, these functions become completely fixed. So these functions, they are fixed up to a prefactor, which is the same F which appeared on the previous slide, so it's a number. And then everything else in these functions is fixed in terms of dimensions of the involved operators and the space-time dimension. So this gives you a huge computational advantage. But how do you use this OPE? So you just use this OPE twice now. For example, you want to compute this three-point function. You use the OPE on the first pair of operators and on the second pair of operators, and you express this four-point function as a sum of all operators exchanged in this channel, in this OPE channel. So whoever is familiar with string theories has seen equations like that. And so this gives you a representation for this four-point function. So I told you that this GUV can be expressed in terms of Fs and deltas, so it's expressed as an infinite sum of products of Fs times these other functions, which depends on the dimensions and spins of the exchanged operators. And these functions are, which are called conformal blocks, are complicated but known special functions. So they don't have a name. It's not something which appeared in the literature, but they can be worked out. So we work them out. So what do you do with this? So now, using this, you can formulate more precisely what this conformal bootstrap is about, so as it was done in the 70s. So you take any four-point correlation function, and you say that I can compute it in two different ways. I can apply the OPE either in the 1, 2, 3, 4 channel or in 1, 4, 2, 3 channel, so I get two representations for the same four-point function, and the only difference between them is that they interchange V and U, because that's how it works. This permutation symmetry works on U and V. And it's supposed to be the same. So you get this equation, and you're supposed to impose this equation on all four-point functions of your theory. And the unknowns for which you have to solve are Fs and deltas and spins. So you get an infinite number of equations for infinitely many unknowns. And that's why it was for a long time thought to be hopeless, because you didn't know where to start. So how are you going to disentangle this infinite system of equations? So the brief history of Bootstrap was that shortly after it was formulated, it was abandoned, partly because people moved to QCD and to supersymmetry. And then in the 80s, it was resurrected in two-dimensional case because with extra tricks available in two dimensions, you can actually carry this program out, and it was carried out for a few theories. And then in three dimensions and higher, we wrote a paper with Riccardo Ratazzi, our student Alessandro Vicky, and Pietro Minotti's student Eric Tonni, where we resurrected this in higher dimensions. And since then, there were many works by other people. So this program now is very much alive. So let me tell you how it works. So let me give you an example of how it works on the three-dimensional easing case. So let's go back to the 3D easing. And let me first of all show you what is known about 3D easing from all the calculations based on the randomization group. So all those calculations, they have to be, they can be reduced to this set of numbers that I give on this table. So these are the dimensions of operators of the three-dimensional easing model. And as you see, they are known with some sometimes impressive precision, like 10 to the minus 4